Hello, B here, and welcome back to biology. Today we are moving into the plant kingdom. Let's take a look at a few examples we might find here. In tropical areas, we might come across palm trees such as these, or you may have seen a field of dandelions growing. And then a few weeks later, the same field looked like this. Same plants, different parts of their life cycle. If you've explored alpine areas in the northwestern US, you've likely come across these Indian paintbrush plants. You may have seen ferns like this one growing in a garden or even inside as a houseplant. And there's a good chance you've driven through a large pine tree forest like this one. There is a vast amount of biodiversity in the plant kingdom. Trees, grasses, shrubs, flowers, mosses, ferns. The list of examples could go on and on. We'll take a look at the major phyla and classes of plants in today's lesson. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to describe common characteristics and give examples of the four main phyla of plants. The bryophyte phylum includes the simplest plants, such as mosses. You'll generally find these plants growing along the ground in wet, shady areas. They can't grow tall like grasses or trees because they are non-vascular plants. This means that they don't have specialized tissue capable of transporting water against gravity, so they stick to their role as ground covers. Do you remember your taxonomy mnemonic? Dear King Philip came over for good soup? We are in the Eukarya domain, plant kingdom, bryophyte phylum. What's next? Class. There are three classes in the bryophyte phylum: mosses, liverworts, and hornworts. A common example found in the moss class is this pincushion moss. Lycopodium glaucum. Remember that the scientific name is the genus and species. The only two names we're missing here are the order and family. In case you're wondering for the pincushion moss, it's Dicranales and Lycopodiaceae. But don't worry, usually we'll just use the genus and species for identification. The pincushion moss that we just classified is one of the most common mosses in North America and is even commonly used in terrariums. You may be less familiar with plants in the liverwort class, such as the umbrella liverwort, Marchantia polymorpha. They do look like tiny umbrellas and can be found almost anywhere that has damp soil. But careful if you do see one in the wild. They are poisonous if eaten or even applied to the skin. In the hornwort class, you would find plants such as the smooth hornwort, Phyllosaurus laevis. The Pteridophyte phylum is primarily composed of ferns. These bushy plants dominated the earth during the Carboniferous period in huge swampy forests. They were some of the first land plants and also the first vascular plants. Vascular plants have the ability to transport water longer distances, specifically up against gravity, so ferns can grow taller than mosses. Ferns are still primitive enough to be seedless, however, and instead reproduce by making spores, which can often be seen clinging to the underside of the leaves. We'll learn more about plant reproduction in our next lesson, but for now, know that spores are single-celled gametes, while seeds are multicellular and can be transported longer distances. Ferns are known for being very easy to grow and are often kept as houseplants or used in gardens. In addition to many species of fern, the pteridophyta phylum also includes club mosses, such as the stag's horn, Lycopodium clavatum, and horsetail, such as the field horsetail, Equisetum arvense. When bunched together, these do actually resemble a horse's tail, which is why the genus has the equa prefix. It means horse. Our next group of plants, the gymnosperms, are all cone-bearing seed plants. What's the first type of cone you think of that comes from a plant? There's a good chance that you just thought pine cone. And pine cones come from pine trees, which are definitely gymnosperms. Have you ever looked inside a pine cone after picking it up? You may have seen seeds inside. This is how gymnosperms disperse their seeds, through cones. The word gymnosperm translates to naked seed because the seeds are very accessible and unprotected in the cone. The most common class of gymnosperms are the conifers, such as spruce trees, all the species of pine trees, and fir trees. Most have long, thin leaves or needles that are adapted to cool, dry conditions. Most are also evergreens, meaning they can do photosynthesis all year and do not lose their leaves in the winter. In fact, the needles on some pine trees can last for up to 10 years before being replaced. Other types of gymnosperms besides the conifers include cycads, ginkgos, and gnetophytes. Cycads, such as the sago palm, thrived during the time of the dinosaurs and resemble palm trees, other than the large cone that rests in the middle. There is only one living species of ginkgo, the Ginkgo biloba. It was originally cultivated in China for use around temples, but is now commonly planted in urban areas for shade. Our last group of gymnosperms, the gnetophytes, are shrubs, small trees, or vines. This ephedra plant produces ephedrine, which you may be familiar with as a decongestant. Our last group of plants is the angiosperms, last but certainly not least. In fact, around 90% of plant species currently alive on Earth are angiosperms. So maybe we saved the best for last. They have definitely been the most successful. They are also the most recent to evolve, only making their entrance during the later years of the dinosaurs' reign. We said before that gymnosperm translates to naked seed. By contrast, angiosperm translates to enclosed seed. Angiosperms have a fruit that surrounds the seed and protects it. What's your favorite fruit to eat? An apple, orange, banana, or something more unusual? Regardless, if it's a fruit, it came from an angiosperm. All angiosperms have flowers and fruit. On some angiosperms, such as this sour cherry tree, both are obvious, though usually at different times of the year. On other plants, you would have to know exactly where to look, and the flowers and fruit might be quite small. There are two classes of angiosperms, monocots and dicots. You'll explore the differences between these two classes more in the lesson PDF and find that they show differences in the structure of their seeds, leaves, flowers, roots, and stems. Sometimes it is more practical to group plants not by their scientific class, but by other traits that they share. A common way of classifying angiosperms is into woody or herbaceous plants. You can probably guess that woody plants are trees and shrubs that have some sort of rigid trunk made of wood. By process of elimination, then, herbaceous plants must be the ones without. Herbaceous plants have flexible stems and consist of many varieties of flowers. Another common way to group angiosperms is by their growing periods. Annuals are plants that grow from a seed, flower, produce their own seeds, and die all within 1 year. Many herbaceous flowers fall into this category. If you've ever planted marigolds, petunias, or zinnia in your garden, you know that you have to replant the seeds every year because last year's plants will not grow back. Other angiosperms are biennial, meaning it takes 2 years to complete their life cycle. During the first year, they germinate and grow roots and short stems. In the second year, they grow bigger stems and leaves, produce flowers and seeds, then die. Interestingly, carrots, as pictured here, are usually harvested after the first year because it's not actually the flower that we want, it's the root. And once much of the root's nutrients get used to produce the flower in the second year, there is less nutrition available in the carrot root. Another biennial, Queen Anne's lace, will not flower the first year after being planted. But if you are patient and wait until the second year, you'll likely be treated to a beautiful mass of delicate white flowers. The third group of angiosperms are the perennials. Any flowering plants that typically live for more than 2 years are perennials. Almost all woody plants are perennials, and some herbaceous ones are as well. Herbaceous plants that are perennials often lose their stems in the winter, but they grow back the next year. Lupins and asparagus are herbaceous plants that you could put in a garden and most likely never need to replant. As we went through the lesson today, we saw plants in the bryophyte, pteridophyte, gymnosperm, and angiosperm groups. What they all have in common is their ability to do photosynthesis, as well as a cell structure that we will explore more in the next lesson. In the lesson PDF, you'll have a chance to classify some more plants. Some you may be very familiar with, others you might have to dig up a little info on. Next time, we'll take a look at how plant bodies are structured and how they grow and reproduce. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science. It's the way of life. Hey, hey. See you next time.